we look at the dice game, notice there is an Android support V7 APP something or other, C-O-M-P-A-T-T. All right, if you go here into the project properties, you are likely to have that in a different place than I do. So if you go into, let's see, where is that? Yeah, here. It's liable to show that like with a red X next to it. All right, so what you would do is you would add, it should show up on that list, you'd click it, click OK, and then it should bring it in. And if it's not there, import it into Eclipse or whatever. But that's probably what's missing.
Okay.
All right. Do you have your laptop with you?
No, I do it on a desktop.
A desktop, okay. Take screenshots if you have that problem. Okay. Yes. Right. Well, yeah. Import this into Eclipse, then go into the dice game, right mouse, and then under properties, go and add it as a library. Yeah.
Or the emulator running off the screen.
I don't know. Did you try making it smaller or moving it? when you define the emulator, oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead. Continue.
Oh, but it's really like any window, any open window. It's like control right click or shift right click or something, and then drop down menu comes up, and you can select move or minimize. But you can hit move, and that'll give you like a little arrow.
You can also Yeah, you can create virtual devices, and you can create virtual devices of different types. And depending on the type that you create, it'll be apparently a different size.
If you get a program to work, can you modify it? Can you make a copy of it under a different name?
Yeah, just copy the whole folder. That we did that one of the days in class. We went in the dice game. I went and copied it to dice game V1, and then I continued to make the changes. We'll copy the folder, yeah. Copy the folder and give the new folder a new name. All right. Okay, I want to go over this week anyhow, not just all today, but I want to go over three things this week. One thing, I want to go over table layouts, all right, because that's, I think, required for one of your assignments. That shouldn't be that hard, but, you know, if you've never done it, then it's hard. Right? Just that simple. So I want to go over table layouts. I want to show you a different way that you can attach listeners to things. Alright? And I want to show you a scrolling control so that you can put stuff in it and you can scroll through it. So for example, if you're putting in stuff and you reach the end of the screen, it will give you a scroll bar and you can scroll through. So we'll go over those three things. I hope we get through the first two today, but we'll see how it goes. And we're going to do this with we're going to use Deedle's tip calculator, because that's an example of the table. And it's also an example of, what was the second thing I said? The other listeners. All right. And then the other one is the favorite Twitter search example. That's an example of a scrolling thing, and maybe better than a scrolling thing, it's an example of a UI that is dynamic, that changes. In other words, in the examples that we've had so far, there's been labels and buttons and this and that and the other, but that's what the layout is. Boom. That way forever. There hasn't been anything where like the layout has changed. In other words, there was one image, now there's two images, now there's three images, now there's four images. So we want to see how to do that, to add stuff to the layout dynamically. We've defined the layout in our XML file, but we've never gone and like altered that layout once we've defined it. So we'll see that also in the Twitter example. Yes?
Speaking of the XML, just deal with the fill and rect parent. Fill parent is like auto-size.
Yeah.
And rat parents pick up, but adult parents take up whole space.
Well, it's first of all, wrap content means make it as big as it needs to. Fill parent means fill the container, I believe.
Container being
whatever contains it, right? Because you can have views inside of other views, just like in HTML, you can have stuff inside of other stuff. So when I say the container, I mean the thing that contains it. So it could be the whole activity screen if it's just on that level, but tested, it will be that. So bottom line is try to see what happens. You know, that's always my, sort of that. Because we can sit here and, you know, it's good to have an idea of what's doing it, but you'll really see the difference when you go and see the implications. All right, let's look at the tip calculator. And we'll start out, a lot of stuff going on here. All right. It's not as complicated as it seems, though. We look at resources here. We have our drawable icon. Nothing to see here. All right. We have our layout, a main XML. We have our values, our strings. So really nothing new in the resources. Strings has in it just some strings. Nothing exciting. Let's look at the main XML, and this is what has the table view in it. All right, actually the table layout, I should say. You know, the way this works is, you know, you have to have at least one layout, right? And then from there, you have other layouts. You know, you have the potential to have other layouts inside of layouts. So let me go and copy this, put it in the text edit so we can see it bigger. All right, this is very, very similar to the HTML that you'll see for a table, right? And for those of you that have not done much HTML or don't remember HTML, a table is an element that's like a grid of data, rows and columns. Okay, so a lot of portion of an Excel worksheet, right, where you have rows and columns, all right, the average temperature by month in selected United States. You know, you might have a row for each state, you might have a column for each month, and then you have table cells that have the data, all right. So the table layout wraps around all of the rows. The table itself is associated with, inside each table, is associated with multiple rows. And inside each row, there's multiple other views. Okay? So, here we have the table layout. That's our table. There's some parameters set to it. Stretch columns, that will be the columns that will get bigger and smaller to resize. Table row, this guy has two controls in it. Notice that the length of the second one is three columns. In other words, let's run this and take a look at it. That probably would be good at this point so that we have a visual. All right, so we'll go and we will run this. All right. I'm going to put this up here, and then I'm going to draw how this is a table. Because it doesn't necessarily look like rows and columns. I should probably make this guy stay lit for more than 20 seconds at a time, or however long it's set to. I don't want to do that. I clicked the wrong thing. All right, set it to go off after 30 minutes of inactivity instead. All right, here is our tip calculator. And let me zoom in. Okay, it might be hard to read some of these things, but what we have is we have the bill total that you enter in here. So you enter in the amount of the bill. We then have a table of, if you give a 10% tip, this is how much it is. If you give a 15% tip, this is what it is. And then the reflection, the glare off of this, shows if there's a 20. But there's three columns in here. This one's blocked out, but that's 20%. Alright? There's a tip and a total. Alright? You then have a custom amount for a slider. So, you know, let's say that, you know, if it's mediocre or kind of bad service, you might give a 10% tip. If it's average, you might give 15%. If it's good, you might give 20. Well, what if it's a little better than good but not excellent? Well, this gives you a slider that you can go and you can slide it between 0%, which you probably don't need a tip calculator for that, but I think it goes all the way down to 0. And you could go it all the way up to, I think, 100%. Like if the person, like, you know, brought you your meal and gave you a new car or something like that, you could really give them a good tip. And then down here shows a tip if you pick the custom percent. So let's go in and let's play with this and see how it goes. We'll see. As I type in 122, notice that immediately the tip gets calculated. So you might not be able to read the numbers, but it does get calculated. So as I type something in, it shows me the answer for that. If I slide the slider, so there I slid it up to 55%. I'll give a $600 tip on 1,227, or I can slide it down here. All right? So a couple things notice it's different than this. This doesn't have a button, all right? But it still has controls that the user interacts with, all right? And there's still going to be listeners for those controls. They're not going to be button-on-click listeners, but there are going to be other kinds of listeners for these other kinds of controls, all right? So something has to initiate the code. So there's going to be listeners for these things. The other thing is, this is a table that has four columns in it. And let me draw what the table looks like with four columns. I guess the IntelliSense helps, but it doesn't do everything for you.
No, it'll do everything but create the list.
Yeah, that's what I mean. It won't create the listener, but if you start typing in dot on whatever, it will show you the list of methods that are available.
So it would include the listeners that would be applicable
to that. You can see the methods and properties that exist for that object. All right? Again, you still have to code, right? I mean, it's not going to do everything for you. It's not going to... Probably not, no. We'll see what it does when we go in there. But again, you know that this needs a listener. So you really don't want your IDE doing things for you. Pardon me? Yeah. You want your IDE to help you do things. You don't want it to do things for you. Because if it does things for you, it's liable to do things that you don't want it to do. Well, it will show you the methods that are available. All right, that's what an IDE does. At any rate, this is a table. This table consists of 1, 2, 3 rows. I think that's right. And it consists of 4 columns. All right. This has the word bill total in it. And it has a text box that extends over 3 columns. We then have nothing in this guy. We have a 10% here. We have a 15% here. And we have a 20% here. We then have the word tip. And we have a place for that to be calculated. For these 3 things, we have a total and a place for it to be calculated, and so on. We then have the custom, and we have a slider control that covers 3 columns. Last, we have tip, total for the custom. So even though if we look at the GUI for this, it isn't purely a grid, but it's a grid when you realize that some of the elements go across multiple columns. All right? If you could imagine that, you know, this from here to here is the second column. This from here to here is the third column. This from here to here is the fourth column. So this row and this row has things that span multiple columns. Actually, I was mistaken about the slider. The slider only goes up to here. Then there's a text that shows you the percent that you've chosen on the slider. Okay, so that's how we get, even though it doesn't necessarily look like a table, that's how we sort of have it. And tables, if you think about the kinds of layouts that we've done so far, it'd be difficult to do this with any of the layouts that we've done so far. The best that you could do is that you could have a linear layout, or you could do this 2 different ways. You could have a linear layout, and inside the linear layout for each table row, you could have another linear layout that would spread them out from side to side. Or you could use a relative layout and describe the position of everything in relation to other things. Neither of those are particularly appealing options. This is a grid. All right, a table, a grid, and it's good for lining things up like that. All right, so let's look at this again.
How appealing this thing to be? Is this the more popular option?
Repeat that, please.
In a lot of apps, this is often.
Designers love grids. That's my graphic design 101. Maybe it's before 101. It might be graphic design 099. Designers love grids. Right. I mean, if you look at anything like a magazine layout and all that, you know, that's how they learn to do stuff is by, like, let's make a big grid here and you position things like that. All right. So here's our first table row. And true to be told, there's a text view that has an ID associated with it. Probably doesn't even really need an ID because we're not going to program it, but they put it on there. It's an edit text. And here's where it says that the layout span is 3 columns. All right? So in other words, what this is telling you is, hey, that edit text field that goes here, don't have it just go there. Have it span 3 columns of the table. Layout span that says to go over 3 columns.
That particular combination of characters have a
It's called a namespace. Yeah, it's a namespace. Because what a namespace is keep in mind that, how do I want to put this? ID could be used in a bunch of different places in an application, for example. All right. When we put a namespace in front of it, we're saying this is the kind of ID that we mean. This is a context in which we're talking about IDs. We're not talking about IDs like student IDs. We're not talking about IDs like device IDs or anything like that. We're talking about an ID from the perspective of Android. So it's an Android ID. So it's like qualifying the name that we're using and saying the context for which that name is valid. Yes?
Same thing as importing?
No. I mean, you could stretch it. You could stretch it, but it is similar to it. You input or packages. All right. So here's our text view, and we have that's our first row. I'm sorry. Again, our second row has a 3 things in it. Three text views for the 10%, 15%, and 20%. 20%. To answer your question, those are edit text views. That's what gives them a box around them. All right, you would ask if they're edit or text. But we make them so that they're not clickable. All right, and that you can't put the cursor in them, and you can't give them focus. So, in other words, what this is saying is we want them to look like a edit text box, but not act like one. Yeah. So that answers your question before.
Layout weight?
Yes.
What's the weight?
No clue.
No clue.
No, Google it. Right, right. In other words, we just can't like go and add anything like Android butterflies or something like that. All right, these are all things. Think of these as like being attributes of this object. These are attributes of the things that you can set. All right. In other words, this is a table row. All right, and this is a table view, and we're setting these attributes for it. We're setting an ID for it. We're setting a layout width. We're setting a weight, a gravity, none of these things which I, the weight and gravity, I'm not 100% sure of what they are. But text size, whether you can focus on it. So yes, there's a finite number of these. If you looked up text view, in fact, let's go and do that. Maybe we can kill 2 birds with 1 stone. So if we look at we will see under Android text view, if you look, we will see All the attributes you can set via XML. Android Auto Link, Android Auto Text, Android Break Strategy, Buffer Type, Capitalize, Cursor Visible, Digits, and so on down the line. So yes, there's a finite list of these. I don't know. You're talking with someone who programmed with punch cards. So although IntelliSense is an important functionality, that's not going to be my focus in the class of what the IDE does.
I remember.
Yeah, that's great. But the point is this is a tool. Tomorrow there's going to be a totally different tool. It's going to treat it a totally different way. But programming this stuff is going to be the same. In many important respects, the IDE that you're going to use to develop it is going to be different. An if statement back on a punch card acted the same as an if statement I do today. So if I focused on what holes make an if statement, then that wouldn't be a good way to teach that. Just like if I focus on the IntelliSense and the IDE. That's something 20 minutes playing around with it and you can find that out for yourself. Yes? Different philosophies as far as it goes. Using an IDE is great, it just should not be a crutch, I guess is my point.
If it's available.
Right, but.
Why use a screwdriver to build a house when you have a perfectly good hammer?
That's true. On the other hand, why learn how to add if all you're going to do is use a calculator? Right? You need to know what adding means before picking up a calculator and doing things makes any sense to you. Well, look at it this way. This is like if you walk to school 20 miles one direction uphill barefoot on rocks and someone comes around the next day and gives you a bicycle, you're grateful for it, right? If, however, you were riding in an air-conditioned limo and you had to get a bicycle, then you're going to be cursing it, right? So the idea is if you really learn the stuff and learn the stuff fundamentally, and don't just learn how to use the tool, but really learn the material, then if someone gives you a little bit of assistance, like an IDE, that's great. That's a win, all right? As opposed to relying on the fact that, I'm going to school. That means I'm getting in my air-conditioned limo. If that's not available to you, all right, well, then you might have a problem. All right, so continuing on through this discussion. Notice each one of these has an ID. The only table-y thing about this is the fact that we have organized these things into a table and put rows on them. We're still going to do just like we did in the previous examples. That is, we're going to point to a specific cell of the table by saying, give me the view with an ID of tip 10 edit text. All right? So there's really nothing table-y about our processing language. These could be just text boxes strewn around the screen. We don't care. What makes them into a table is the fact that in the XML, they are defined as a table. All right? All the rows are the same until we get to the seek bar. The seek bar goes from 1 to 100. The attribute which sets what the seek bar is at is the progress. So in other words, in this case, when we open this up, it assumes that it's at 18% for the custom tip. Better than average, but not excellent. So then you can slide it either direction from there. That is a starting position. And that'll be the same attribute that we'll test later on in the code that says, you move the text or the seek bar. Let's see what the new percentage is and let's do that calculation.
What's the limit again?
to 100, 0 to 100. Yeah. I don't know if you can change that. By default, I know it's 0 to 100. I'm not sure. Usually what it is if it's 0 to 100, you then use that to do the calculation to put it into the area that you want to. So for example, if I really wanted a number of, if I wanted a number from 1 to 20, let's say, and I had a seek bar, the seek bar goes from 1 to 100. I can then take that and divide my, or multiply it by progress over 100 times 20 to give me the number I want. So if I was 50% through, it would give me the value of 50 for it. I multiply that by 50 over 100, then I'm at position 10 with the seek bar. In this case, it's easy because you're dealing with percentages, which are 1 to 100 anyhow. All right. Now, we're going to see when we look at the code that the code, there's no difference in accessing, for example, the text boxes. All right, the edit text fields or the text views. We're still going to do the same thing. We're going to create a variable, and then we're going to go in and assign that variable the view that we find based on the ID. All right. So that's why if we look over here, there's a million of these properties, right? Okay, not a million, 20. All right. Why? Because every one of these little boxes here, or at least most, has an instance variable associated with it. All right. Why? Because we know we're going to have to point to this guy and do something with it. All right. So if we change the bill total, we're going to have to recompute this guy and recompute this guy. And recompute this guy, and recompute this guy. Right? So whatever we put in here, we fill out the table for the 10%, 15%, 20%, total, total, total. Then we also use the custom percentage to figure out a tip and a total. So any number we change up here, we are going to change this, 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 and this. So one number change, we're going to change 8 of those field cells. All right. If I move and I drag the custom thing, I only change 2, this one and this one. Because again, these percentage rates are fixed at 10, 15, and 20. So moving the custom percentage, this is the values for the custom, so only these two guys change. And this guy changes to show us what the percentage is. All right. So because of that, we have to point to a lot of stuff on the page. That's why we look, we see we have a whole ton of instance variables here. All right. So the table control, the table view, table layout. The way we're using it here, there's nothing different that we've used before. We are simply grouping things together in a grid. All right. Now we're going to see other examples of this where we're going to dynamically create a table where our table isn't always going to have, what is this, 6 rows. All right, but maybe it has, starts out with 2 rows and when we add a 3rd row, a 4th row, a 5th row. All right, and in that case our coding is going to be different. But in this case we have a fixed number of rows, so this is going to be just like the previous examples in terms of how we access the stuff on it. The only difference is visually they're going to be arranged in a grid. All right, so let's go and look at our activity. Whoops. Don't look. This is Elsie's orientation quiz. Of course, I assume you've all passed orientation if you, if you are here today. All right, so let's go. But that was a use of XML. I wanted to be able to create a quiz, but I didn't want to hard code the questions, right? And I wanted to randomly choose the questions among a list of questions. So I put create an XML file that has the questions, the possible answers, and which one was correct. So actually kind of happy with how that was coded. All right, let's go in here and let's look at this. And we're going to see a lot of statements that look the same. Repeat that, please.
The carriage for the greater than and less than with the exclamation and the dashes is
actually yes. Non-empty. Yes. All right. So here's all the stuff that we are importing. Pardon me?
Editable is different than edit text.
Yes. Okay. So we have these two things, and we'll come back to these later. This relates to restarting the application, like going to another application and coming back. We won't worry about these for now. Here we have the custom bill total, or the current bill total, and the custom percent. All right. This is filled in based on what the user types into that one edit text field. This one is set based on the seek bar. We have a whole mess of edit text attributes, instance variables. Why? Well, because we have to go and set each of these anytime you change this, as well as these two. And anytime we change this, you have to change these three. So we have to point to each of them so that we can say, well, this guy I want to make this value, this guy I want to make this value, and so on. So we have instance variables for each of those. All right. We're going to ignore this restoring from memory business, and we're going to come up to here. We just have a bunch of things that look exactly like we have before, where we have something equals, in this case, edit text, because that's what that guy is, find view by ID, r.id.tip10editText. So what does that do? Well, again, it finds a thing in the UI that has an ID of tip10editText. And that would be this guy. All right. We know that's an edit text field, and we want to treat it like an edit text field. Therefore, we cast it as an edit text field. All right. That's essentially what this says. Hey, this is going to give me back a view. It's going to give me back whatever view happens to have that ID. But we've stacked the deck, and we know that that's an edit text field. So therefore, we're going to say, hey, I know that's an edit text field. Let's treat it like an edit text. So up here, I declare that as an edit text. And here I say, well, take that view. Let's make sure we treat it like an edit text. We do that for all of those text fields that we're going to set. All right. So from here to here, these are the different cells that we're going to set the answer in. All right, these are where the results of our calculation is going to go. Here is the bill edit text, find view by ID. Here we're grabbing a pointer to this guy. We're grabbing a pointer to that edit text. All right. Well, why? Obviously, we need to know something about that, right? We have to react when the user changes it. Notice again that in this example, we're not basing our calculations based on clicking a button. As soon as we enter into that field, it starts doing the calculations in real time. So if I type in 1, it figures out the 10% tip on a dollar. If I then type a 0, it gives a 10% tip on $10. And if I type in a 0, it'll give me a 10% tip on $100. So as we're typing, it does that, not waiting until we typed in the full amount and then clicking the button. So in order to have that functionality, we need a text changed listener. All right. Likewise, the seek bar, we're not sliding the seek bar around and hitting a button that says calculate. As soon as we slide that seek bar, the calculation changes. Therefore, we need an on seek bar changed listener. All right? These are analogous to the on-click listener that we had the other day, right? Except it's looking at different views and it's looking at different interactions with them. This relates to when the value of a text box gets changed. This relates when a seek bar gets slided. All right? Now to your question, what would IntelliSense tell me about this? If I was writing this new and I typed in Bill edit text dot, it's going to show me a list of all the functions that are available. And down here, there's going to be add on, add text change listener. All right? So, I could find that, yeah, I have to add a listener to this. I guess what I'm suggesting is if you have to do that for everything, it's going to be very tedious to code to search through the list. Because that's just the A's. All right? There's a boatload of methods here associated with this method. So, yes, IntelliSense will help you remember the fact that the way that I put on an add change listener is this method. 1 second. But I sure wouldn't want to depend on IntelliSense to tell me I needed to set the on text change listener. I better know that there is such a thing as a text change listener on a text box. All right? And if I need a refresher on how to set that, well then, okay. Yes?
Can you click back to nothing?
Yeah. Yes. We'll come to that in a minute. We haven't, that's declared further down on the line. I wanted to just show how we're setting the listener first, and then we'll go and we'll look at the details of that. Okay? And pretty much the exact same thing is done to the seek listener as well. I'm sorry, where do you see? This?
Yeah, is that the function it's called? I can't
remember. No, this is the listener object.
Okay.
This is the object responsible for handling when the seek bar changes.
Okay.
This is the object that's responsible for handling when the edit text box is typed in.
But that is a name of something else.
That's a name of something else that we haven't seen yet.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, that's almost the exact same question, you know, asked.
Yeah,
like what is this? Yeah. Yeah. That is the code it's gonna handle. It's like we did, but if you want an analogy, it's like when we said set on click listener this, where we plugged in an object that could serve the role of an on click listener. Here we're plugging in objects that can serve the role as an edit text listener and a seek bar listener. We just haven't seen those objects yet. Yes. This is a neon create method. Yes.
Wouldn't you get a compile error because you didn't declare it in the neon create method?
Nope. No. Well, we didn't get a compile error, so even if programming, I could answer that one. Well, we'll see. You're jumping. You're like trying to like look at it at the end, last page of the book, and find out who did it. Right? We gotta get to that point. Let's understand what we're doing here, and then we'll see the details of how that object gets created. Just trust the fact that there's an object out there called Bill Edit Text Watcher, and we're plugging it in here. In a second, we'll see where that came from. All right? Now, to answer two questions, down here, we have, somewhere down here, we have our two listeners, which are effectively instance variables. We have an onSeek bar change listener that we are calling custom seek bar listener, and it equals new on seek bar change listener, and it has all the methods in here. And we have the same thing for the text watcher. These are called inner classes. In other words, they don't get their own class file. Typically, the rule in Java is that one class is in one file. So if you have a Java class, it's in a file named, you know, class.java. All right? This is an exception to that rule because these classes sort of, how do I want to say, are, these classes depend on this object being around for them to be around. All right? These objects are tied very closely to this. This is a code that happens when that text box changes. So it doesn't make sense to have this code somewhere else because this code only works when that text box exists. So it doesn't deserve its own class file, in other words. We want this class to be able to access everything about the parent class as well. So we declare it inside of that, and that's called an inner class. It's also, if I'm not mistaken, an anonymous class because we don't really give a name to the class. We give a name to the object. We simply say, I have a text watcher named Bill Text Watcher equals new text watcher. We haven't created a class called My Text Watcher. We are simply using the text watcher class that is in the Android framework. Now, and this is something a little confusing. Let me go and Google it. Oops. That's actually an interface, right? So we can create an object based on an interface like that? I guess we can, right? Now, what does it mean when we say it's an interface? It means that this object has to be able to fill the role of blank. In this case, it has to fill the role of a text watcher. It has to do all the things that a text watcher can do. Because if it can't do that, then it can't be the text watcher for that text box. Same thing with the seek bar. Everything I'm saying about the text bar applies to the seek bar. All right? Now, the question is what do you need to be able to do if you're a text watcher? You need to be able to respond when the text changes. So that's a text watcher's job, is to respond when the text changes. So when the text changes, you need to have some code. And that code is the onTextChanged method. There's two other methods that we don't need in this case, but we have to put them in there anyhow. Why do we have to put them in anyhow? Because that's how interfaces work. When you define an interface, you have to accommodate all the methods that are declared on that interface, even if you don't do anything. That acknowledges, hey, I know this guy has to handle this, but I'm not going to do anything, but I'm recognizing the fact that this guy is responsible for it. So I have to put that method in anyhow. So the two methods are after the text changes and before the text changes. So like this would be like before they start typing. This would be after they're done. And this is when the text has changed. All right? Notice that there's not a lot of code in here. All right. Remember we talked about that before. These event handlers, these listeners, themselves don't have a lot of code. They simply are the glue between the UI component and your other business rule functions, if you will. So, this text watcher implements this interface sort of implicitly by saying new text watcher. By implementing an interface, you have to have whatever the methods are on that interface. In this case, on text changed, after text changed, before text changed. And really, the only one we're interested in this case is on text changed. So as the text has changed, in other words, as I've typed something in there, I'm going to execute this code. Let's look at the seek bar listener, and we'll see the same thing, sort of. All right? On seek bar change listener, it is an instance of on seek bar change listener. All right? My custom seek bar listener is an instance of on seek bar change listener, which is an interface, which means we've promised to implement these methods. So what methods do we have to implement? We have to implement on progress changed, on start tracking touch, on stop tracking touch. But the only one we're interested in is when the progress is changed. In other words, if I touch the seek bar and don't drag it, I don't need to do anything. It's only when I drag that seek bar over from one percentage to another percentage that I have to run code. Yet again, because these are interfaces, I have to at least have a dummy method in there saying, yes, I know that seek bar interfaces have these things. All right? One way to tell if it's an interface, a couple ways to tell. One way is if we go back to the dice game, we can conclude by looking at the code that, I'm looking at the wrong code. We can look at the code, we can tell that onClick listener is an interface because it's implemented. So that's one way to tell it's an interface. Another way to tell it's an interface would be if we go in this guy. If I forgot to implement a method, I'm going to cut this out for now, and I go to compile this, your project has errors. If we look at the errors, it's going to say something to the effect of, all right, not sure what that is, but the new type seek.bar onChange listener, we could expand that, must implement the inherited abstract method. That's a clue that says this is an interface, because I've created this and I haven't created that method. Now, for normal classes, there's no law that says you have to have this method or that method, so if you're required to implement it, it's either an interface or it's another abstract method. I don't want to get into what abstract methods are now, but abstract methods are a way to get a little bit into the same functionality of an interface except with a regular class. So those would be two clues that you would get that you're dealing with an interface. Oh, okay. What happened to that? Oh. All right. So, we create these two inner classes, which are anonymous classes, because we're not giving a name to these classes. All right? We're just saying it's an onSeek listener. All right? We're not saying that it is my onSeek listener, which inherits and all that. All right, it's inside of this, so it means it only can be used with this, but that's okay, right? I know that I preach about reusability all the time. I say, you know, writing code that's reusable and all that. There's some code, though, that by its nature, there's little to no benefit to making it reusable. And that is the code that sort of glues together your UI and your business logic function. Your business logic, you want to be reusable. You want to be able to call that function from several places. But the code that says, what do I do when I change this specific text box is really only relevant on that specific activity for that specific text box. We're not going to reuse that code. So I don't care if that code, if I write another one of these and I have to duplicate that code, that's okay because there's really not much in it to begin with. All right? This down here where I say, I create an instance variable called onSeekBarListener, customSeekBarListener. So the object is called customSeekBarListener, but there's no real name to the class. The class is simply a new class that's implementing onSeekBarListener. So this is that. And I have the code to implement that like right there, right contained within the curly brackets.
Can you go back down to the bottom of what you
highlighted? Mm-hmm. I spelled the semicolon. Repeat that, please.
I spelled the semicolon at curly bracket. I got confused for a second.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's talk about this because this instruction I found like confusing the first time I saw instructions that look like this. So let's spend a minute breaking it down. All right. Normally we would do something like this. Normally I would say die d equals new dice die. And then I'd end with a semicolon, right? And this die is a class definition that's somewhere else. That's in its own file. All right? And it would go into create one of these. Here I'm saying, let me get the exact, it's private, first of all. What type is it? On seek bar change listener. All right. And I'm giving it a name, custom on seek bar listener equals new. All right. So far, exactly the same as this, right? Except I forgot to put private up here. All right. Private die d equals new die. Private, name of the class, variable name, equals, new. So far, this statement is identical to this statement. Here's where it differs. Because we don't have a class definition in its own file. So we define it right here. All right? I say a new onClick listener equals new onSeek bar change listener, and I define the anonymous class right here. Of course, because this is an interface, I have to define so many methods. And okay, here I've defined all the methods. I'm done defining my class. And then that's the semicolon that corresponds to that semicolon there. All right, so that's why there's a semicolon at the end. It's sort of finishing up the declaration of this variable. And instead of having like already a class definition where it can just go out and do that, I put the code for the class right here. But that class doesn't have a name, right? It's just an onSeek listener. We didn't give it a special name. Hence, it's an anonymous class. And it's also an inner class because it's, the logic for it is defined inside another class's definition. All right. Now, let's look to see what these two do. All right? Because the code that these do, and this again, why how do I want to say this? The code to process this stuff is simple, all right? When we get down to actually running the code, it's just a handful of little math calculations, you know? Take the amount, multiply by 10%, multiply by 15, multiply by 20, add it, blah, 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 blah. The tough thing is wiring your components together, all right? So that a change here causes this calculation to go off and causes these text boxes to get filled. So that's the trick, and that's the difference between writing programs now and then. Now you're dealing with everything's an object, everything's a component, all right? So certain low-level functionality is taken care of for you. I don't have to draw on the screen what a text box looks like. There's already a text box object. But I have to wire that text box to my code so my code can do stuff with it. So let's look first of all on the text watcher. On text change, so as I type in a character, what am I doing? Well, I'm taking, I'm taking the character sequence that got typed in there. All right. This represents the current value of the text box after the change was made. So S, that argument S, is what's in the text box. I'm taking that and I'm making sure it's really a number. So I'm trying that and I'm trying to set the current bill total to that. Otherwise, I'm throwing an exception. Now here's the interesting thing. This is a case of like wearing a belt and suspenders at the same time, right? If you remember in the XML file, we said that you could only put numbers in here. But guess what? We're still checking to make sure that's a number. Why? Because I don't want some person changing my UI to allow alphabetic characters by mistake or misunderstanding or whatever and having my code blow up. So even though I can only put numbers in there, I'm still testing by doing the checking for an exception to make sure it's a number. So we'll assume that everything's okay, that we've entered in a number. What we're going to do then is we're going to call update standard and update custom. Now, where do update standard and update custom live? Because this is an inner class, we can call the methods on the parent class. So update standard and update custom are methods on our activity. And update standard simply goes and does the math. It takes the current bill total times 10%, that's the 10% tip, adds it together to get the 10% total. Does some string formatting so that it displays it as as a currency, as two decimal points. Does the same thing with 50%. Does the same thing with 20%. And so on. This guy. I'm saying the text, but I'm doing some formatting of the number first. Probably. I'm guessing it would round. You could always Google it and say string format and it will tell you more than you would ever care to know about the string format. My guess would be that it's rounding it though. We could test it, right? I could enter in a bill for $10.98. And it shows a tip for 10% as being $1.10. So it rounded it. If it truncated, it would have been $1.09. Okay. Now, after we update the standard, we update the custom. And the custom takes and it looks at the custom percentage, does that calculation, and updates the custom. So really, sort of anticlimactic, right? I mean, once we've gone through all the trouble of wiring all that stuff together, the calculation is trivial. We're just doing some calculations and stuffing the result back in there. The important part is getting all the components to talk to each other. You raised a question, I think, in either this class or maybe you mentioned in the Java class about how tough this is. And again, the tough part of it is the fact that you don't simply have one place where all these things live. That the UI is in an XML file, and strings are in another file, and your code is in another file, and so on. You gotta get all those things working together. All right? That is the tough part. But that's where the power of the language comes in as well, and that's where the power of the platform comes in. All right? Because of that, internationalizing this is trivial. One of the assignments, upcoming assignments, you have to make an international version. So use Google Translate and pick another language, all right, and create a strings file that have translated terms in it, all right, and that'll be easy to do, and you don't have to do anything. Why? Because it's a component-based architecture, all right. All you have to do is swap out a new values file, and that's done for you. All you have to do is define the component, and it will work. Now, let's look at the seek bar. And the seek bar... Did I go past it? Yeah. All right, here we go. This is easier still. We can't possibly have an exception with a seek bar, right? You can't slide the seek bar and turn the number into a letter somehow, right? It's going to be somewhere on that range. And as I said, that range goes from, I think I said 1 to 100 before. I think I actually mean 0 to 100, all right? So that's going to be a value from 0 to 100. And then so I set the current custom percentage to that, which is an attribute of the activity. Then I call update custom, which goes and updates these two things here. Anonymous or inner?
But it's also an interface. You still have to implement everything?
Oh, yeah. If you implement an interface, right. Right. Doesn't matter. You implement that. You have to implement it, again, even if your method doesn't do anything. All right? The way that it's always described, or that I've often seen it described in textbooks, is that an interface and an implementation is a contract. When you define an interface, anyone that implements that interface promises to have these methods on it. Now, you didn't promise that you have to do anything in those methods, but you do have to define those methods. So that's why if we look here, in our particular example, we're only interested in this one method when the progress bar changes. That's when we're going to set the custom percent and then do the calculation. All right? When they start touching it, we don't have any code there, but we still have to have that method defined there, even though it doesn't do anything. Likewise with this, likewise with the text watcher. Again, notice that if we change the text box, we have to update the standard percentages and the custom. So in other words, if we change this number, we got to update this, 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 and this. If we change the seek bar, we only have to change this and this. So the way it's written is it broke those things down into two methods. And in the case of changing the text box, we call this with this. In the case of changing the seek bar, we just change the one, wherever that was. Here. There we go. We only changed the custom. Notice again, that none of the work is done in the event listeners. The event listener simply sets the properties and asks and hands off to another function that actually does the work. That's a general good programming practice, not to put a lot of code in the code that is the event listener. All right? It's simply going to be the wire that hooks up the control to the real functions that do the work. Yes?
Where did you define current customer?
That is an attribute of the activity. Current custom percent. In other words, so it's an instance variable, so it's available throughout the class and throughout the inner classes, as a matter of fact. All right. Just like, again, because this is an inner class, I can call update custom, even though that's not part of this class, but it's part of its parent. But because it's defined in there, I can do that. In a nutshell, all those listeners do is set this variable and this variable, all right, and then call the methods to do the calculations. The one calls two methods, the text box calls two methods, the seek bar calls one method. And really, most of the code is about, in this, is about connecting, is about pointing to the different controls on the page, on the screen, connecting the action that the user can do on a couple of those controls with our listeners, and then going and actually doing the calculations. So really, the stuff that I want to get from this, and again, some of these needle examples are good. Some of them start to be a little bit of a yawner, all right, as you go through them, because there's a lot of stuff in them and it's not terribly exciting, and sometimes they do things sort of in a backwards way and whatever. The point, though, is that from each of these examples we're going to go over in class, there's something specific I want you to get so that you can use it going forward. And what I want you to get in this case is, number one, the table layout, how that worked, how we define it in the XML, and because this is a static table, how the code really doesn't matter. All right? Our code to look at these text boxes doesn't matter if it's in a table or not. These text boxes could have been anywhere on the page, and we're still grabbing pointers to it, doing our thing, and so on. All right? The other thing that I want you to get from this is the different listeners. Different in two respects. Number one, it's no longer a button with an on-click listener. It's a different view that has a different user action associated with it that has a different listener associated with it. All right? And new in that, I created the listener object in a different way. All right? Now, I could have said, tip calculator extends Android activity, implements on text box change listener, on seek bar change listener. And I wouldn't have had to have any of these classes at all. All right? Problem is that would get to be confusing, because you have a lot of stuff in there. And if you had a lot of, how do I want to put this? If you had a lot of GUI elements that the user could interact with, it would get really confusing if all your eggs were sort of in one basket. All right? It's much better to modularize and say, okay, this chunk of code is handling the seek bar, this chunk of code is handling the text box. Questions on any of this? What we'll go over next time is the favorite Twitter app, favorite Twitter search. It's just a way for you to define a list of things, a list of topics that you want to like track on Twitter. So just in case you want to see if Miley and Nikki are still fighting or whatever, you could put that as your favorite Twitter search or one of your favorite Twitter searches, and then click a search box and bring it up. So you could save all these Twitter searches and then do the searches and get that. So there's a little app to do that. What's going to be different about that is it's going to be our first example of where our GUI is going to be dynamic. That is, it's not predefined as a certain number of things. We're going to be adding things dynamically. If we add 3 Twitter searches, there's going to be 3 things on the screen. If we add 4, there's going to be a 4th, and so on. So that'll be our first example of seeing that. If you want to take a look at that beforehand, that's fine. That's a part of that one that we're going to be focusing on, though. All right? Questions? All right, that's it. It'll implicitly convert an integer to a double, yeah. So if I have int x equals 1, double d, and I say d equals x, yeah, it's fine. Pardon me? That's a good question. I'm not sure if it will give you a compiler error or just a warning. But yeah, you would run the risk of losing it. So like if I had a double called, x and an integer called y, if I said y equals x, I'm not sure if it would give me a compile error or if it would simply like just not run. Or would run but do the truncating, I mean.